The following contains spoilers for the entire God of War series, including Ragnarok. You have been warned. Greetings, fellow mortals. One of my favorite storytelling experiences this year was God of War Ragnarok. I'm not lying when I say that I have been looking forward to it since the 2018 game Dad of Boy came out. That was 4 years of buildup, and I feel that it didn't disappoint. In a lot of ways, Ragnarok is my favorite game of the year. Now, Elden Ring still tops it as a game, but I am a storytelling guy, and I will remember those last few hours of Ragnarok for years to come. I was so emotional at the end that I was ready to burst into tears.
Am I crying? No, I'm not crying. You're crying.
Ever since I reached the ending and 100%ed the game, I have been stewing on the story. So many parts are really strong, except when I had to go grocery shopping with Atreus. That wasn't fun. The boss fight after that was fun, but Jotunheim could have been cut down a lot. I could spend several video hours gushing about the quality of writing with Thor, Kratos, Freya, Sindri, and Atreus. Hell, I could specifically talk about each boss fight and how important each one was to the story.
Oh, beautiful.
Not to mention the beauty that was the twist with Tyr. For this video, however, I want to discuss the importance of mountaintops in God of War. Now, that might seem like a weird transition. Here I am talking about the importance of character growth in God of War, and then I talk about mountains. It's a big turn, but I wanted to bring up the parallelism and symbolism with Kratos and the top of mountains throughout the God of War series. His character is defined by him looking off the peak of a tall drop and drowning in the emotions of the moment.
I'm the king of the world!
Well, not exactly like that. I mean, the original God of War starts out with Kratos looking over the mountainside, stating that the gods of Olympus had abandoned him and that there was no hope. Then he throws himself off the side of the mountain in a desperate attempt to find peace that the gods denied him. He spent 10 years suffering from visions of killing his family by accident. The gods promised to redeem him if he served them and killed Ares. Once he fulfilled his purpose, they refused to remove his visions, stopped him from putting an end to his own suffering, and turned him into the new God of War. In retrospect, they probably should have found a way to make Kratos forget his past before raising him to deity status.
Not a great plan.
The next time that Kratos was staring over the mountain, it was when he lost his last two remaining family members. He was forced to kill his mother after a curse from Zeus turned her into a monster. Then, his brother Deimos fell in battle after being separated from Kratos for an entire lifetime. Once again, Kratos was looking over the side of the mountain. He stared into the abyss and almost stepped off to his doom. It's not exactly clear why he stopped himself. It could be that his anger had grown too strong. He might have hesitated because he knew that the gods would stop him from pulling a Canada on himself. No matter what, Kratos didn't have anything else to live for in that moment.
Life sucks, and then you die!
Of course, that led to Kratos destroying the entire Greek world. When he looked over the edge of the mountains, he stared into the darkness of the abyss, and as always, the abyss stared back. The Greek saga of Kratos worked so well because it drowned in despair. Behind all of the flashy boss fights and violent kills was a man without hope. Kratos had nothing to live for other than his hatred of the gods. The constant pain in his life broke him in a way that he became the absolute monster that we see in God of War 3.
You think I'm a monster?
I think you're confused.
The reason that the Norse saga is so powerful is because of how dismal the Greek saga was. Nothing about Kratos' life was pleasant. Even alcohol and beautiful women were momentary distractions that didn't help. As always, I denounce the coitus minigames. They're pretty immature, admittedly a little funny, but immature all the same. But unlike most people, I don't view the old God of War games as non-thinking, non-feeling games games without any heart in them. They do have heart, and I think that a lot of it comes from the parallels of the mountaintop.
Not today, old friend. But don't worry. Holidays are just around the corner.
Many moments in the Greek saga happen on the mountaintops. Chains of Olympus ends with Kratos lying exhausted on the cliff where he would later attempt to end his suffering. God of War 2's final boss happens on a mountain. The entirety of God of War 3 occurs on Mount Olympus. Kratos' time in the Greek world ends with him overlooking the destroyed planet while on top the ruined Mount Olympus. That's where he forsakes his vengeance and frees the power of hope from his body to give the world a chance to move on. It wasn't redemption, but it was the start of Kratos' new existence.
All I'm saying is, you gotta start somewhere.
And that leads into Dad of Boy and Ragnarok. Both of those games finish with Kratos standing at the peak of the mountain, overlooking a vast landscape. In the 2018 game, it's Jotunheim. In Ragnarok, it's Midgard. Both of these scenes are extremely emotional moments for Kratos. They stand in complete contrast to the three times that he tried to end himself in the Greek saga. P.S. Sorry for dancing around the actual word here. YouTube punished me last time that I talked about topics like this, so I'm being extremely careful. It would be nice to know exactly what the rules are here.
What are the rules?
Oh Christ, I'm singing again.
In God of War, Spread the Ashes, Kratos has an emotional journey where he and Atreus come to an understanding of each other. Through his love of his son, his fight with Baldur, and his decision to be better, Kratos finally finds a way to forgive himself. While overlooking the edge of the highest peak in all the Nine Realms, he undoes his bandages, exposes the chain scars on his arms, and finally lets go. A lot isn't said, but I think in that moment, he finally finds a way to forget about his daughter and his first wife. The visions finally pass because he found a path forward with his son.
That's beautiful, man.
It helps that his daughter Calliope was shown to have no hatred of her father during Chains of Olympus. When it came to his family, Kratos found peace. It might be a coincidence, but I find it fascinating that we were able to see Kratos actually sleep without nightmares after this event, both at the end of Dad of Boy and throughout Ragnarok. As always with fiction, I might be reading into something that isn't exactly there, but that's the beauty of this series. There's a lot of show instead of tell. We don't know exactly what everything means.
What does that mean? What does that mean?
The same thing could be said for Ragnarok. After an emotional farewell with his son, Kratos finds himself at an impasse. The thing that helped him move forward from his past was gone. He no longer had the path of protecting Atreus. Fortunately, there was an answer left for him in the form of a prophecy. Kratos finds a retelling of his own story. He sees his arrival in the Norse world, his battle with Thor, and a possible future where he is being worshipped by the people of Midgard as the god of peace and the new Allfather.
I am the god of destruction!
While the 2018 game ends with Kratos' internal redemption and peace, Ragnarok concludes with Kratos becoming a god worthy of being worshipped. He has truly changed from who he once was. To the people across the Nine Realms, he's a hero and a general. Even previous foes like Freya respect him. For the first time in his whole life, he's beloved by the people around him, other than Spartans, of course. Realizing that he ended the war without becoming a monster once more, and instead a god that people are happy to revere, Kratos is overwhelmed to tears of joy for the first time in his life.
I don't think that I can handle this right.
I don't think that I can handle this right.
I don't think that I can handle this right.
I was reminded of Odin's rant from earlier in the game, where he comments that Kratos doesn't understand what it means to be worshipped. Besides Sparta, no one has ever looked to him for answers or guidance. In fact, I don't know if I exactly have the right words for this, so here's what exactly went on in my head.
And what kind of god
is that? Kratos? What do you even know of godhood? In your lifetimes, has anyone ever worshipped you? Ever prayed to you? Can you even imagine that kind of love? No! You don't care about mortals. You don't care about anything beyond yourself, beyond the monster who kills without cause. You fear what you can never even hope to understand.
And I found this to be one of the most powerful things in the game. Finally, after a lifetime of suffering, Kratos has found peace in himself, good relationships around him, and a people who view him as a hero. He's no longer defined by who he once was. In fact, my only complaint is that I hoped that the Norse saga would be a trilogy. That way, the number of times that Kratos tried to Canada himself on a mountaintop would be equal to the number of times Kratos found redemption on the peaks of the Norse Nine Realms. But as always, if my biggest complaint about something is that I want more of it, then I should probably know when to shut up. I just found that the parallels between the mountaintop moments to be extremely powerful, especially with Freya being there at the end of Ragnarok. Kratos promised to never take away the choice of death from her again, and that parallel with his own previous attempts to end his own suffering emphasizes that Kratos is ready to be the god that the Nine Realms need. It's truly beautiful, and one of the reasons why I think that Ragnarok is one of the best stories told in 2022.
Wow, you make history come alive.
But what do you think? Am I completely off base here? Did you notice the parallelism in God of War? What's your favorite part of Ragnarok? Please leave a comment down below. I'd love to hear your perspectives. And thank you so much for watching. If you like my takes on storytelling, please consider subscribing and liking the video. It would really help me out. Also, please remember that I'll be self-publishing my novel, Dance of Frozen Death, at the start of 2023. I hope that you will check it out. I appreciate you. Do not despair.